So the Legal Lounge here on CRN Digital Talk Radio, crntalk.com, streaming live coast to coast and around the world on crntalk.com. Also available in stunning high definition video on facebook.com. You can drop us a note there if it's facebook.com/crntalk. Also on CRN's custom built Roku channel where you can watch us on the Roku. It's free in the Roku store, as well as on crntalk.com, and of course on our friends at tikilive.com as well. I'm joined, as always, by the one and the only, an active attorney, U.S. Army vet, Juris Doctorate in Law, undergraduate degree in physics, and author of a book that has proven to be a guideline for the Supreme Court now and in the future. That book, America, Delusion, Freedom, is available on Amazon, Barnes & Noble, and on iTunes. Ladies and gentlemen, Mr. Richard Nixon. Sir, how are you?
I'm very wonderful, Mike. How are you?
I'm very well. I'm very glad to be here.
I'm very anxious to see if the Republicans are going to clean the other side's clock, like I hope they'll do. But just kind of on a lighter note, something that we kind of anticipated after the Dobbs election, that the left will not quiet down. They will not quit, even though they've, quote, if you, in their terms, they've lost. And very briefly, let me just say this, that our Attorney General, Rob Bonta from California, says that he's warning against compliance with other states' abortion laws. And he says that there is a law in California, AB 1242, a new state law that bars cooperation with laws restricting abortion in other states. The law, sponsored by Bonta's office, is the latest salvo in a growing battle between the red and the blue states. Now, he says that there are apparently 23 states that have implemented abortion bans following the Dobbs decision, and he's thinking what one or all of these states will, when they try to impose their laws in California, will disguise them as either elder abuse or child abuse or something to that effect. And he's saying just be wary. And he reiterates, he said, I've said this before and I'll say it again, we will protect anyone who comes to California in search of reproductive care, including access to safe and legal abortion.
This sounds like a political stunt to me, more than anything else. I don't understand how, you mentioned before the show, how with our full faith and credit clause, how someone could go from California to Mississippi to get an abortion and pretty much just say, well, I'm from California, I don't have to abide by your laws. That seems kind of off base to me.
Right. And you mentioned the full faith and credit clause, and I'll read it very, very rapidly here. Article 4 of the U.S. Constitution, full faith and credit shall be given in each state to the public acts, records, and judicial proceedings of every other state. And Congress may, by general laws, prescribe the manner in which such acts, records, and proceedings shall be proved and the effect thereof. So I think what he's doing is creating a problem with the full faith and credit laws, because if the laws of a particular state say no abortions, and they come to California and they seek an abortion, it's very possible they'll be in violation of the state of Alabama or whatever.
Stick around, folks. We'll be right back. Big show today. Stay around.
No more mold. No more damage. No more outdated old bathroom. No more slipping and hurting. No more stress. Make your ordinary bathroom extraordinary for only $99 per month. New shower, new door, new tub, new wall, new anti-slip technology. Be stress-free. Call 800-973-5411. BCI Bath and Shower is made in America for the highest quality. Ask about our military and senior discounts. Your dream bathroom in as little as one day. First 50 callers save $1,500 on a Neverclear glass treated door. Call now for free premium color upgrades. 800-973-5411. Call BCI Bath and Shower, the leader in bathroom remodeling. Be smart, safe, and stay a step ahead of inflation with our interest-free financing options. Call 800-973-5411. Love your bathroom with free upgrades. Call 800-973-5411. 800-973-5411.
We are back in the Legal Lounge, CRN Digital Talk Radio, crntalk.com. Once again, thank you so much for joining us. America, an Illusion of Freedom. That's Richard's book. We're going to be quoting from it extensively today because we've got a lot to talk about. It's fascinating, folks, about how our system of government, as the founders envisioned, has completely been changed to from a loose confederation of states to a strong centralized central government, federal government, which I believe was anathema to what the founders envisioned. Real fast, though, we should mention get well soon to Paul Pelosi.
Absolutely.
The husband and financier of Nancy Pelosi, Speaker of the House of Representatives and a congressperson here from California. He was assaulted by an deranged lone assailant.
And many people have said, where was his police guards and
security guards,
that they expected that that house would be, at least maybe the neighbors object to it. Maybe that's the problem, because I was not under the, I didn't know that they lived so close to other people.
Mm-hmm.
I imagine them out in a vineyard somewhere all by themselves.
No, they're deep in the heart of San Francisco.
Yeah.
And we wish them all the best in a swift and speedy recovery, because we abhor any sort of political violence, left or right, in this country. That's why we have the ballot box. That's why we have civil discourse and political freedoms here in this country, because we express ourselves peacefully and through the ballot box rather than through violence, because that's what they do in banana republics. And
very
so,
well said, Mike.
Thank you very much. So let's talk about the meat of the show today. We want to talk about this. We teased it on the last show about how we got here, how we got to a place where it seems like the Supreme Court, and you write about this extensively in your fantastic book, American Illusion of Freedom, how nine unelected justices sitting high up in robes in Washington with all the creature comforts they can want and with no accountability to anybody but their maker, how do they actually make laws for the rest of us? And this all started, there's three triads here we kind of want to get into. We're building a skeleton. We're going to get into more specifics and further in future shows. But this is a term known as the Incorporation Doctrine. The Incorporation Doctrine. Briefly, the Incorporation Doctrine means that the Bill of Rights is applied to the states. And that is not what the founders intended. What was the founders' intent with the Bill of Rights?
Well, that's right. In order to do this, as you said, Mike, we've got it like a trifecta here. We've got three steps, and I know different people have been confused about this, so we'll maybe just touch on it today and maybe go over it again next week if we get any comments to the effect that they're still interested. The first thing is that the Bill of Rights, which were enacted 2 years after the Constitution in the main, 1791, there's nine so-called Bills of Rights that the Founding Fathers, through their state, through their existing Congress at the time, limited the federal government. I have to underline the word federal. They were limiting the government that they had just created in 1789, or 2 years previous. So basically what they were saying, and the first one gives us a clue, Congress shall make no law respecting an establishment of religion, prohibiting free speech, et cetera, et cetera. I won't read them all. But the first eight amendments there after 1791 are considered the Bill of Rights. They were intended without question to apply to the federal government only. That was fine. Everyone seemed to understand that until we came to 1868 and the 14th Amendment. 13th and 14th Amendments were unique in the sense that they were after the Civil War, and they were directed toward the states. And the 13th, 14th, and 15th Amendments were basically saying, now you states are going to be included in the Constitution, and we're going to control you to a certain extent. That is, Congress is going to write some law here in the Constitution that limits what the states can do. Now, the 13th Amendment very briefly talks about neither slavery nor involuntary servitude shall be exist within the United States. So the 13th Amendment stops slavery. The 15th Amendment talks about the right of citizens to vote. If they are citizens, they cannot be denied based upon their race, color, or previous condition of servitude. Now, previous condition of servitude obviously was directed to the slaves. The former slaves, yes. So that's the 13th and 14th, the 13th and 15th. Now, the 14th has an interesting clause in it that says that nor shall any state deprive any person of life, liberty, or property without due process of law. Now, again, that was basically saying that every state, if they're going to deprive a person of life, liberty, or property within their state, they must comply with some due process of law when they do it. Now, it's not specific as to what that process must be. So until that was fine until about the 1930s and 40s, when the U.S. Supreme Court started applying the, and this is kind of complicated, started applying the Bill of Rights, which, remember, was only intended to apply the federal government. They started applying it to the states. For instance, no prayer in school, no God in school, no Ten Commandments in school. And the vehicle by which they did that was the 14th Amendment Due Process Clause, which most people recognize is just a specious argument.
Well, they used the substantive due process for a majority of those decisions. And like you said, the due process of law from the 14th Amendment, we should note too that there's also due process clause in the Fifth Amendment. We're gonna circle back to that shortly. But the 14th Amendment, due process clause, nor shall any state deprive any person of life, liberty, or property without due process of law. And I think most people would consider, if you just read that they're talking about administrative due process. For example, procedural due process. An unbiased tribunal, notice for proposed action and grounds to assert for it, opportunity to present reasons why proposed action should not be taken, the right to present evidence, the right to know opposing evidence, the right to cross-examine adverse witnesses, so on and so forth.
Right.
Procedural due process. But what we saw, especially in the 1930s, 1940s, all the way up to the 1970s, and even now today, even a little less today, is substantive due process.
Correct.
Where they extrapolate from the text of the 14th Amendment Due Process Clause, life, liberty, or property, they take liberty.
Right.
Which I think the founders intended as confinement.
Yes.
And that what they do is they take liberty and they define it in a very interesting way. The United States Supreme Court has interpreted the term liberty in the Due Process Clause very broadly. Although the court is not assumed to define liberty with any great precision, that term is not confined to mere freedom from bodily restraint. Liberty under law extends to a full range of conduct which the individual is free to pursue, and it cannot be restricted except for proper government objective.
Yes.
And that, when you take the word liberty and make it as broad as that, you can drive a truck through that.
Right. Well, Justice Thomas has done research on the word liberty back to the 1200s in England, and it's always been used to talk about confinement for having done something wrong. It had nothing to do with granting other rights, if you will. The other thing, too, that the word liberty, the Supreme Court has taken great liberty in using the Due Process Clause by expanding it when there's clearly no documentation, there's no reason in the Constitution why, when, as we said, the Bill of Rights was always intended to apply to the federal government only, there's no basis for applying it to the states.
Now we're going to talk about how that has gotten warped over the years right after the break. Stay with us.
Are you paying too much for term life insurance? There's a tremendous price war among the major term life companies. Rates have dropped dramatically in the past 2 years. For example, a man age 45 non-tobacco user, $1 million of coverage is only $75 per month, level for the next 10 years. Or a man age 50 non-tobacco user can buy $500,000 of coverage for a monthly premium of only $110, guaranteed not to change for the next 20 years. That's right, level rates for 20 years. And if you're a smoker, we have great rates for you as well. At the Term Lifeline, we specialize in policies of $500,000 and above. So if you're looking for new or replacement term life insurance, call right now for a free quote.
Rates and availability may vary by state. Sample rate quotes are based on preferred non-tobacco underwriting exam required to qualify.
800-349-6855. 800-349-6855. 800-349-6855. That's 800-349-6855.
Have you heard about vine-to-bar chocolate? It's the winemaker's chocolate, the world's first chocolate made with Wellvine Chardonnay Mark. from the beautiful coastal vineyards of North America. Gently pressed grapes are harvested after juicing, dried and finely milled, and carefully blended into the finest dark chocolate. The Chardonnay Marc contains highly beneficial grape nutrients, flavanols, and has a natural sweetness that flavors the luscious dark chocolate. Mouthwatering, flavorful, delectable dark chocolate goodness with Chardonnay sweetness and beneficial nutrients. And it's alcohol-free, too. It's Vine to Bar Chocolate. Order some today at vinetobar.com. That's VINETOBAR.com. Cold shipped to your door, it's Vine to Bar. Vine to Bar Chocolate. Visit us at vinetobar.com.
Hi, this is Fred Dwyer talking about my favorite Italian restaurant, Angelo's and Vinci's at 550 North Harbor Boulevard in downtown Fullerton. A fantastic place to eat. Come inside and dine in our Italian town square, complete with a 10-foot Christmas tree. That's right, 10 feet. Enjoy our food made from secret family recipes. Pasta, chicken, seafood, salads, and our delicious pizza. Incredible desserts, including my favorite, the tiramisu, flown directly in from Italy. Feel the spirit at Angelo and Vinci's, 550 North Harbor Boulevard in Fullerton, California. Call 714-879-4022 or visit angelosandvincis.com. That's angelosandvincis.com.
Once again, talking about the Incorporation Doctrine and why that's important to you guys out there, because it pretty much makes the federal government, currently led by Joe Biden, the arbiter of anything that happens. More specifically, the Supreme Court can change law, and they were not elected to do so. I want to talk, Richard, to go back to the founding a little bit, and yes. The founders were attached to the idea of federalism, that the states within the union were the primary governing units. And as you mentioned, the Bill of Rights was to protect both individuals and the states themselves,
right,
from impositions by the central government. Just so that we're clear on that last point, the purpose of the Bill of Rights was to state very clearly and plainly what the federal government may not do.
Correct.
That's what they were attached to the Constitution. Interestingly enough, according to some scholarship, the framers actually emphatically rejected a proposal to give the federal government veto power over the state laws.
Right.
But now we've seen that's been eroded through the courts. But so 1791 is pretty much commonly accepted that the Bill of Rights was not to be applied to the states.
Right.
But then we also saw that codified at the Supreme Court with a particular case from the 1830s.
Correct.
Barron versus Biltmore, correct?
That's right. Barron versus Biltmore was the case that went before the Supreme Court, 1833, which defined the concept of federalism and basically held that the Bill of Rights did not apply to the state governments. And that was a reaffirmation of what we have already been saying, that the Bill of Rights applied only to the federal government, not to the states. And it wasn't until the 14th Amendment Due Process Clause, 1868, which left itself wide open, if you will, the Due Process Clause, for someone in the 1930s and 40s, our Supreme Court, to start misinterpreting, I use that word purposely, misinterpreting the Due Process Clause by applying from that date forward in many cases when it comes to prayer in school, God in school, Ten Commandments, etc., applying the Bill of Rights to the states rather than as was intended to apply only to the federal government. And that's where we are now, but it looks like this current batch of justices might be ready to reverse that.
Yeah, just going back to this decision from, it's a Barron versus Baltimore. This is 1833,
correct,
where the Supreme Court, under friend of the semi-friend of the show, Chief Justice John Marshall, and the majority held
right
that as the founders intended, that the Bill of Rights was only applied to the federal government, correct, not to the states. And in his opinion, Chief Justice John Marshall wrote the following. He demonstrate that to demonstrate the constitutional limits did not apply to states unless expressly stated, Mr. Marshall, Chief Justice Marshall, used the example of Article 1, Section 9 and 10. And I quote, the third clause of Section 9, for example, declares that no bill of attainder or ex post facto law shall be passed. No language can be more general, yet the demonstration is complete that applies solely to the government of the United States. The succeeding section, the avowed purpose of which is to restrain state legislation, declares that no state shall pass any bill of attainder or ex post facto law. This provision then of the ninth section, however, comprehensive its language, contains no restriction on state legislation. And I repeat, contains no restriction on state legislation.
Correct.
So we have John Marshall here, Chief Justice of the Supreme Court, in an 8-1 decision, saying that the federal Bill of Rights only applies to the federal government and not to the states.
And then we have to remember, when it applies, it's a limitation on the federal government. It is not a grant of power to the federal government. Because remember, it's the states who were writing this thing after creating this behemoth called the federal government in 1789. Some had second thoughts and said, well, wait a minute, we've given them all this power. We want to limit them now.
And even in 1791, 1789, 1791, certain states saw that the power of the North, the industrialized North, was becoming far greater than the agrarian South.
Correct.
And they needed some sort of protection if a majority took over the federal government of northern wealthier states to impose their will and their values on the southern states themselves, who had less economic power.
Correct.
And so it was the framers' intent to keep this a loose confederation of states where the most power resided in the states themselves, and the federal government was more of an organizing body, calling balls and strikes here and there, but
yes,
having no place to dictate what laws could be passed in those states.
And to reassure you on that, the 10th Amendment was passed. It was part of the Bill of Rights by some people. It was also 1791, which basically said, no law given under this Constitution to the federal government resides in the people and their states.
And 1868 comes along.
Right.
We get the 14th Amendment. We get the 14th Amendment Due Process Clause. And things start to change, but not for about 70 years. We're going to talk about the slow crawl towards authoritarianism under Supreme Court making laws, nine justices sitting high, unelected, in robes. Stay with us.
You're experiencing pain, back pain, shoulder, elbow, or hand pain from a sports injury. If so, schedule a visit with Dr. Michael Sheps, the leading expert in laser therapy for pain management. Call 310-873-4422 or go to drsheps.com. Experience Epic T, the breakthrough laser therapy system that Dr. Sheps developed to make you pain-free in less time. Laser therapy is a non-invasive, safe, and effective in-office procedure that penetrates deep into your skin without damaging the tissue. It perfectly targets areas of pain to promote fast, natural healing. Relax your muscles, ease muscle spasms, joint stiffness, and arthritis pain while increasing blood circulation. For over 25 years, Dr. Sheps has helped Olympic athletes and sports enthusiasts alike get back in the game. Schedule your visit with Dr. Sheps at his Brentwood office in California. Call 310-873-4422 or visit drsheps.com. That's drsheps.com. 310-873-4422.
Let's talk about your credit cards. When you first start using them, it's a slow drip. You make charges, then more charges, then bills come, and they keep coming. When you open your statements, the floodgates come pouring in. You realize you have more credit card debt than you can afford, and you're barely making the minimum payments. Wouldn't it be nice to make one affordable payment and have all your credit card bills covered? Make this free call and learn our responsible way to get your credit card bills paid and under control.
Sponsored by Consumer Education Services, a nonprofit organization.
800-876-3643. 800-876-3643. 800-876-3643. That's 800-876-3643.
CESI is not a loan company. The establishment of a debt management plan may adversely affect your credit rating. Non-payment of debt may lead creditors to increase finance and other charges to undertake collection activity, including liquidation.
When you really want Italian food, you have got to get to Columbo's. Columbo's Italian Steakhouse and Jazz Club. Colorado Boulevard, Eagle Rock. It's that little neighborhood place you wish was down the street from you. Today, it seems so hard to enjoy just a little bit of easy. So much of life seems to get in the way. But fear not, seekers of fabulous food and fun and thrill, Columbo's is Southern California's answer to easy street. Great grub with some of the finest steaks, the freshest fish awaiting for you to devour. Did I mention Columbo's family Italian recipes? Columbo's spaghetti bolognese, their chicken pesto ravioli, magnifico, and of course, the world's greatest meatballs. I can go on. But why go on when you can go on over to Columbo's and experience delicious and easy for yourself? Columbo's, of course, that little neighborhood place you wish was down the street from you. Columbo's, mangia bene.
Now you can get generic Viagra shipped to your door for about $2 a pill. Get the same impact for less. Call Steel Man Pills now and get the same blue pill for about $2 a pill. Call now for the 50-pill special and save even more. Plus, get a free bonus.
800-605-1683. 800-605-1683. 800-605-1683. That's 800-605-1683.
Hi, everybody. Michael Horn along with Fred Dreyer here in the Sports Lounge. We look behind the scenes and the world of sports, do we not, Fred Dreyer?
We look behind and in front sometimes.
Really? So
yes.
Check them both out and you can see everything there. This isn't your show for sports scores. This is the show about the politics of sports.
We're not ripping and reading. We don't care about what the Phillies and the St. Louis Cardinals did in the third inning on a rainy day. Who cares? We're here to give you insight into a certain part of the sports world you don't normally see.
Wednesdays at 4 on CRN.
Back in the Legal Lounge, CRN Digital Talk Radio, CRNTalk.com. Richard writes extensively about the fallacy of the Incorporation Doctrine in his fantastic book, American Illusion of Freedom. It's available where fine books are sold, Amazon.com, Barnes & Noble, and on iTunes. So we kind of covered it up to the 14th Amendment up until 1868. The founders envisioned the Bill of Rights to only protect, to limit the government, the federal government itself. We saw that held up. The Supreme Court affirmed that in 1833 with the Biltmore case. And now we have the 14th Amendment Due Process Clause. And you mentioned, too, the 13th, 14th, and 15th Amendments, the post-Civil War amendments.
Right.
And we should look at those in context of the time.
Sure.
That these were, I would argue, and I think I have a good...
You might even be right.
I think I have a good plank to stand on here, that this was solely to address post-Civil War and Reconstruction of bringing former slaves.
Correct.
And codifying their rights to citizens.
Correct.
I mean, that seems logical to me.
Up until then, we had no definition of citizenship in the Constitution.
Mm-hmm. And now we've seen, you know, fast forward about 70 years, we saw the 14th Amendment specifically used to pretty much open the door for all sorts of crazy stuff going on.
That's true. And remember, last week we talked about that phrase, and subject to the jurisdiction thereof,
yeah,
which we won't get into again today. But again, that was the whole point, that only certain people were going to be permitted in this country to become citizens, which is what makes what President Biden is currently doing with the open southern border so egregious.
Absolutely. Stick around for articles of impeachment on that probably in about 3 or 4 months. Let's just real fast, Richard, and I've heard this argument before. The Fifth Amendment has a due process clause.
It does.
As well. The text is as such. No person shall be deprived of life, liberty, or property without due process of law. Now we have one, the same, in the due process clause in the 14th Amendment, Section 1. Nor shall any state deprive any person of life, liberty, or property without due process of law. And so I'll come back at you a little bit saying, like, well, we have the government has the right, the people actually through their representatives have the right to amend the Constitution.
Yes.
So Didn't the people then, through their representatives, amend the Constitution to say, hey, we want the Bill of Rights to apply to the states? Because it says right here in the clause, in Clause 1 of Section 1 of the 14th Amendment, nor shall any state deprive any person of life, liberty, or property.
No, that's, but again, I'm not sure I understand, Mike, because the actual Fifth Amendment says it has a due process clause, which applies to the federal government. Now you have the 14th Amendment applying the due process clause to the states, so they're covered. But again, if the 14th Amendment due process clause applied to the states, it would be redundant because you already have the Fifth Amendment with the due process clause applying to the federal government. So it would be redundant as I see it.
Because mm-hmm. that's built on the framework that, yes. And I think that we both believe that the Bill of Rights and the amendments to the Constitution in general are applied only to the federal government, not to the states themselves.
Absolutely.
So now we let's fast forward a couple of years. Now we see something coming along called selective incorporation, where kind of piecemeal they'll go through, and you saw this a lot during the Lochner Court, 1897 to 1933, where they'd be like, look, you know, we're going to look at these case by case, and we're going to see if any sort of due process was violated, and then adjudicate that thereof. Now we see, especially in come forth during the Roosevelt administration, the Hughes Court, where you really saw substantive due process be used in all sorts of decisions from the Supreme Court to really make law.
Oh, absolutely. And Mike, I have to thank you for such an excellent job in research. You and your crack research staff, we have a list here of no less than 30 specific amendments incorporated by case law. Now, what I mean by case law is this wasn't done by Congress. This was done by our Supreme Court in the 30s and 40s and 60s. Now, I'm not sure what happened in the 50s. Maybe that's something that one of our listeners can research for us. But in any event, there's 30 different situations here, case law, which basically shows how the Supreme Court ruled shotgun over the states now, not just the federal government, like it did in Roe versus Wade, like it did in Marbury versus Madison in 1803. But now you have the Supreme Court micromanaging every law of the states, as long as some attorney can claim that it's a violation of one of the Bills of Rights, you've got authority under the Bill of Rights for the Supreme Court to micromanage the states, as I said.
And this once again gets us back to substantive due process.
Yes.
Because before, I mean, due process, procedural due process, hey, you know, you fill out your paperwork, you got to, you know, cross your T's, dot your I's. But then substantive due process, where they extrapolate that from the word liberty, which we now, as we've mentioned yes. in the last segment, can mean anything. We have substantive due process. And some of the criticism of substantive due process, I think, is worthy of discussion here. Oliver Wendell Holmes Jr., he was a realist. I personally have issues with him because of his opinion in the Schneck case, but we can talk about that in a different time. He says this.
You're showing off now, man.
I know. He said this about substantive due process in one of the last dissents he ever authored from the bench. Quote, I have not yet adequately expressed the more than anxiety that I feel at the ever-increasing scope given the 14th Amendment in cutting down what I believe to be constitutional rights of the states. As the decision now stands, I see hardly any limit but the sky to the invalidating of those rights if they happen to strike a majority of this court for any reason undesirable. It's 1927.
Yes. And in other cases, Justice Frankfurter has made the same comments. Every time he would see one of these decisions, one of these 30 decisions made by the Supreme Court in, if you will, micromanaging the states, he called that just a every day we're creating a constitutional convention by the Supreme Court. Now remember, Article 1 of the Constitution says only the legislature, composed of two bodies, the House of Representatives and the Senate, shall make law. We have 30 examples, according to your documentation here, Mike, of examples of where the Supreme Court erred seriously by writing law that they had no right to write, and the most...
Well, hold on, Richard. We're going to the break. We're going to get through some of these cases right after the break. Stick around. We're in the Legal Lounge.
Very good.
Do you have Medicare and do you use a CPAP machine? This is a national healthcare alert regarding your CPAP supplies. Using a clean CPAP mask and clean supplies is important to staying healthy. The best way to make sure your CPAP equipment is clean is to get new supplies. If you have Medicare, we have great news. Medicare will pay for you to have new clean supplies every 90 days. We'll even do all the paperwork for you to make sure that there's little to no out-of-pocket cost to you. And you don't even have to leave your home. We provide free in-home delivery. So if you're a CPAP user and you have Medicare, staying healthy with new CPAP equipment is easy. Just make this free phone call right now to get started.
Sponsored by Specialty Medical. 800-846-2153. 800-846-2153. 800-846-2153. That's 800-846-2153.
Have you heard about vine-to-bar chocolate? It's the winemaker's chocolate, the world's first chocolate made with well-vined Chardonnay marc from the beautiful coastal vineyards of North America. Gently pressed grapes are harvested after juicing, dried and finely milled, and carefully blended into the finest dark chocolate. The Chardonnay marc contains highly beneficial grape nutrients, flavanols, and has a natural sweetness that flavors the luscious dark chocolate. Mouthwatering, flavorful, delectable dark chocolate goodness with Chardonnay sweetness and beneficial nutrients. And it's alcohol-free, too. It's vine-to-bar chocolate. Order some today at vine-to-bar.com. That's vinetobar.com. Cold shipped to your door, it's Vine to Bar. Vine to Bar Chocolate. Visit us at vinetobar.com.
And we are back in the Legal Lounge. This is an important topic, folks, because this really goes to show how our democracy has kind of been usurped by the court.
Yes.
How the Supreme Court can now make law from the bench, even though I think with this new court we're seeing, we might see a sea change when it comes to that usurpation of power from unelected officials sitting on the bench. Real fast, though, I want to get in a couple more quotes. This is from Justice Byron White,
yes,
who was not necessarily considered an originalist. He's been critical of substantive due process as well, as pronounced in his dissents in Moore versus East Cleveland and Roe v. Wade, as well as his majority opinion in Bowers versus Hardwick. White argued that the doctrine of substantive due process gives the judiciary too much power over the governance of the nation and takes away such power from the elected branches of government. We've been saying that since day one on this show.
Absolutely.
Also, Thomas and Scalia have things to say about substantive due process, too. And now we've seen the Dobbs decision. The Dobbs decision flies in the face of all these other decisions I'm holding up in my hand right now, where the court made law, where Dobbs actually gave power back to the people. And that's really rare for any country to do that. Right, Richard?
Exactly. And that's why I said kudos to you, Mike, for not only uncovering these 30-some cases, but it's in recognition of why I wrote my book in the first place, is because I felt that the behavior or conduct of our Supreme Court was egregious in the fact that they found things in the Constitution that did not exist, and therefore they took that issue away from the people and gave it to themselves. Now, for me, that is, I'll just use the term, unforgivable, because the Constitution is really a contract between the people and our newly formed government. The government promised to obey the words of the Constitution. Now, we all know that we're not kids anymore, but the point is we know that they're not going to be perfect. However, the conduct of our Supreme Court has been egregious, especially in the 30s and 40s and 60s, and it's my hope, I would like to say that it's because of my book that the current membership in the U.S. Supreme Court is kind of changing, but it's interesting that they are. It's as though they had read my book and said, you know what? Nixon's right. We're going to have to start shaping up and changing things. And so they went back 50 years and realized that Roe and Casey were not in the Constitution, and they righted the situation. And like you said, Mike, to use your terms, What other country is so generous as to give power that it has back to the people?
It's amazingly rare. And people say about the Constitution, well, it's so old, it's outdated. Yeah. But we were just talking during the break, when the former Soviet Union fell and all its satellite republics fell as well, and new governments had to be established, they had to write new constitutions.
Correct.
And who did they bring over? American constitutional scholars and originalists.
Exactly.
To write the Constitution, because it's the envy of the world. And like you said,
absolutely,
no other country other than America, based on our Constitution, has amassed so much power and done so much for good.
I believe so. That's absolutely right.
Well, some of these cases, we're actually going to talk about some of these cases specifically next week, but let's go through them. First Amendment, you want to have a semi-organized prayer after a football game? Can't do that anymore because of Emerson versus Board of Education. You want to have guaranteed freedom of the press? Been incorporated. Gitlow versus New York, freedom of speech, same. Gitlow versus New York, Stromberg versus California. Guarantee for the right to petition for redress of grievances, incorporated. Edwards versus Mouth. Guarantee of freedom of expression association, NCAA versus Alabama, 1958. All and on. We're going to get into more of these next week. And the most recent one, interestingly enough,
yes,
2010, a case we've talked about, McDonald versus Chicago.
Right.
And the Second Amendment incorporated to the states. Interestingly enough, though, certain rights, certain clauses of the Bill of Rights have not been incorporated.
That's right.
Specifically, we see Hurtlow versus California, 1884, the right to indictment by a grand jury not been incorporated.
Yes, they've done it piecemeal, and this is what Justice Black on several occasions has said. How can we do this? How can we argue that the Supreme Court, or I should say, that the Bill of Rights protects people in parts of the Fifth Amendment or the Sixth Amendment, and not others? It's based upon individual judges deciding what's important to them, and it should not be piecemeal. We should just incorporate the whole bloody mess here, Articles 1 through 8, and incorporate all that and apply all of them to the states. To the states.
Very interesting enough, too, in the Seventh Amendment, an amendment often not talked about, the right to jury trials in civil cases, not incorporated.
Correct.
Justice Black, didn't Justice Black say, just incorporate the whole thing?
Yes, he was.
And that's not necessarily the solution that you would offer, correct?
No, I would say, of course, incorporate none of them, because if we go to Chapter 8 now, if you do that, I urge you to read Chapters 1 through 7 first, however.
Of course.
But Chapter 8 gives the solution to all this mess that is, and what that is for the Supreme Court to take the Due Process Clause of the 14th Amendment, the Due Process Clause, which says no state shall deprive a person of life, liberty, or property without due process of law. We go back to 1868, when it was applied only to the federal government, and start backing off on all these cases that since then, in the 30s, 40s, and 60s, the Bill of Rights has been applied to the states. Just start repealing those, we'll be back to where the founders intended. And for those of you who say, why are we going to go back to what these old people did in 1789, 1791? Because we have those old people knew what they were doing, because they gave us the fifth Article 5, which was the right to amend. We've amended the Constitution some 27 times. We know how to do it. If you want to amend it, if you want to change it, you do it the right way, according to George Washington. You don't do it by allowing the Supreme Court to have a daily constitutional convention.
Yes, because the amendment process relies on the legislative branch.
Only the legislature, absolutely.
And not those nine unelected justices sitting high up in the
rooms.
Correct. Stick around, guys. We'll be right back. Stay with us. Hello, everybody. Mike Gary here at CRN, reminding you to join us in the lounge Monday through Friday at 4 p.m. Pacific Time, 7 p.m. Eastern Time, right here on CRN Digital Talk Radio. Mondays, join Mike Horn for a fantastic lounge show. Tuesdays, it's the Legal Lounge with Richard Nixon, and yes, he is live. The Sultan of Safety's Fred Dreyer in the Sports Lounge on Wednesdays. Thursdays, it's the Business Lounge with financial expert John Truman Wolf. And on Fridays, head into the weekend with Mike Horn. The Lounge, Monday through Friday, 4 p.m. Pacific Time on CRN Talk.
Hi, this is Fred Dreyer talking about my favorite Italian restaurant, Angelo's and Vinci's at 550 North Harbor Boulevard in downtown Fullerton. A fantastic place to eat. Come inside and dine in our Italian town square, complete with a 10-foot Christmas tree. That's right, 10 feet. Enjoy our food made from secret family recipes. Pasta, chicken, seafood, salads, and our delicious pizza. Incredible desserts, including my favorite, the tiramisu, flown directly in from Italy. Feel the spirit at Angelo and Vinci's, 550 North Harbor Boulevard in Fullerton, California. Call 714-879-4022 or visit angelosandvincis.com. That's angelosandvincis.com.
Do you want to fly somewhere, anywhere in the world? Smart travelers call myflightsearch.com for the best deals on flight tickets. Going to Manila, Bangkok, London, how about Singapore? Call myflightsearch.com for the lowest flight tickets available. What about a local vacation? Let's say you want to fly to Vegas, Orlando, Miami, Los Angeles, or Denver. Pick up the phone and call myflightsearch.com right now. We have exclusive deals that you can't find anywhere else. The only way you can get these low airline prices is by calling us. We have so many low prices available, we can't possibly tell them to you right here and now. If you're flying somewhere anytime in the next 6 months and you want the lowest airline ticket prices anywhere, you owe it to yourself to save a ton of money. So pick up your cell phone and call myflightsearch.com right now.
Call 800-445-3166. 800-445-3166. That's 800-445-3166. Call now. 800-445-3166.
Then you will know the truth, and the truth shall set you free. John 8:32. Hi, this is Jeremy Dayton. Join me Sunday nights at 9 p.m. Pacific on Truth Radio, where we'll unpack the cultural baggage and discern what truth is amongst the sea of disinformation, the truth from God's perspective. With powerful guest testimonies, we'll also expose lies of the world created to spread fear and confusion. Matthew 6:34 says, "Therefore, do not worry about tomorrow, for tomorrow will worry about itself." Let's do that by seeking God's truth together. Sunday nights at 9 p.m. Pacific on CRN6.
And we're back in the Legal Lounge. And we don't want to really cast aspersions on the drafters of the 14th Amendment. I think that their intentions were good post-Civil War. Things had to be addressed. I think we take issue with, especially, you know, in the Hughes Court and the FDR Court, where substantive due process became a thing. They made it up and used that to ramrod any kind of legislation they wanted through the courts. But the 14th Amendment has an interesting clause in there. It's very, very prescient of the drafters of the 14th Amendment to include Section 5 of the 14th Amendment. And what is that, Section 5 of the 14th Amendment?
Well, yeah, remember Article 14, 14th Amendment, we always talk about Section 1, citizenship, due process, liberty, and equal protection. There is, however, a Section 5 which says the Congress shall have power to enforce by appropriate legislation the provisions of this article. Now, that is somewhat unique also, because that allows Congress to amend, if you will, the amendment without having to go through Article 5, which usually takes years to construct a new amendment. So the problem today, of course, is that with the current administration or the current Congress, or the makeup of the current Congress, there's not much chance they're going to fix this, but the Supreme Court could fix it by, if someone were to bring one of these 30 cases, if you will, where the Supreme Court has gained jurisdiction or power over these states, if they were to bring a case like that and ask the court to honor it, the court could very easily say, well, we're not going to honor it. We're going to go by the original meaning of the Due Process Clause. We're only going to apply this state, Bill of Rights to the states, and therefore, we're only going to apply the Bill of Rights to the federal government. Therefore, it does not apply to the states, and therefore, we have no jurisdiction.
I think
I think we might actually already be on our way to that, Richard.
Great.
Because we just saw a case in the Supreme Court. This is from last term. Dateline here is June 27th, 2022. This is a case we've talked about before. This is Kennedy versus Bremerton School District. This is about that high school football coach that would after the end of the game.
Yes.
The players would come to the center of the field, and they'd engage in an informal ad hoc prayer session. Not compelled. The coach wasn't compelling anybody. He was completely voluntary.
Correct.
But local courts at that time said that violated the Establishment Clause, Everton versus Board of Education.
Right.
And we saw the Supreme Court rule in this court's favor 6-3.
Yes.
And so perhaps you might be right that if more cases like this, you know, that are fly in the face of Everson or in Cantwell versus Connecticut or Gitlow versus New York come to the Supreme Court, and we've already seen the Supreme Court in Dobbs say, look, we don't think that substantive due process holds constitutional water.
Right. And to remind our audience that one of the most egregious decisions I feel that the Supreme Court has handed down is no prayer in school, no God in school. And the most egregious, I think, is no Ten Commandments in school, because the court felt that if they actually looked at the Ten Commandments, they would venerate them and try to follow them. And that is, of course, unconstitutional. That is so ridiculous.
It should be noted, too, that the Bill of Rights is venerated in all three Abrahamic religions, Judaism, Islam, and Christianity.
I see.
So it is pluralist in its intent right there.
Yes.
So I think, like, you're right. I think with this Supreme Court, constructionalist court, that if we see more of these cases, challenge these 30 cases of the Bill of Rights being incorporated to the states, we might see a sea change here.
Yes, we might have the atheists raising hell, but I think we can put up with that.
If you don't believe in hell, how can you raise it? Richard, we're out of time. That was a lot of fun.
Good point.
All right, we're going to stick around next week. We're going to talk about some of these specific cases that were incorporated, some of the important ones, because I think it's important to discuss. And perhaps there's other cases that will challenge this precedent. So, Richard, thank you very much.
Thank you very much.
And thank you, everybody out there, for listening and watching. As always, all previous sessions are available on YouTube. Just find Richard's playlist on YouTube. A couple new ones were added this week. Also, his podcast, crntalk.com/podcasters. See you guys next week in the Legal Lounge.